This video is brought to you by Bright Sellers. What's up, guys? Helen here. You don't have to be a Charles Manson superfan to know that cults have taken over American culture, though it wouldn't hurt. Indeed, it seems like every day a new HBO documentary drops, primed to explain the powers of brainwashing or the dangers of supposedly charismatic volleyball enthusiasts. Seriously? Him? That bandana? Those socks? Just fly me to the moon with no return ticket. Anyway, on top of that, we've seen the continued rise of what author Amanda Montell calls cultish groups in her appropriately titled book, Cultish. Take America's $35 billion multi-level marketing industry that's invaded every corner of social media, convincing you to hawk luxury leggings or poop-inducing diet pills. Or look at fitness fanatics doing SoulCycle twice a day with their favorite pathologically likable instructor, Braxton. In short, as Montell writes, for good or for ill, there is now a cult for everyone. On an unrelated note, Wisecrack is having its first retreat in rural Montana later this year, so stay tuned for details. Still, it's easy to feel like cults are a uniquely modern phenomenon, a symptom of a broken society where nobody wears pearls to church on Sundays anymore. But the truth is a lot more complicated. In fact, there's a strong argument to be made that cults have been part of the American social fabric since the moment a few prissy Puritans landed on Plymouth Rock. We'll explain in this Wisecrack edition, Did Cults Make America? But before we get into it, I want to give a shout out to this week's sponsor, Bright Sellers. You know that we love to break down complex ideas at Wisecrack, but after a long day of reading disturbing accounts of cults, I don't want to think about my after-work drink. And this is where Bright Sellers is a game changer. Wine can be complicated, and it's hard to figure out what you like. But Bright Sellers is the monthly wine club founded by two MIT graduates that uses an algorithm to match you up with wines that you'll love. Just take their 6-question quiz, and Bright Sellers will recommend great wines that will hit all the right notes for your palate. And even if you have zero prior wine knowledge, all they need is your preferences on things like juice, chocolate, and tea to figure out which types of wines you'll love. And as you review the wines they send you, they'll get to know your taste more and more, so your wines are even more specific to you. For example, I now know that I am perfectly suited for a cool climate Pinot Noir. Who would have known? If you're of legal drinking age, you'll get these delicious wines shipped right to your door, which is much more fun than staring at the wine aisle at the grocery store trying to magically teach yourself Italian. And because I enjoy learning what I drink, I love that each bottle comes with a wine education card that gives tasting notes, shows me how to pair wines, and lets me know which temperature to serve it at. It makes wine tasting feel way less snobby and makes for an amazing at-home date night. Right now, they are offering 50% off your first 6-bottle box, but only if you hit the link in the description. So go on and treat yourself. Now, back to the show. Now, to understand why cults have captivated the country, we first need to figure out what the heck a cult is anyway. Unfortunately, that, much like the milk crate challenge, is easier said than done. See, the word cult didn't always invoke sexy, knife-wielding Manson teens. In fact, when it came into use in the 17th century, it merely meant to worship anything. The definition only really began to shift around the late 19th century, when it began to refer to scary religious groups like the Mormons. The turn of cults from neutral to super negative was also somewhat rooted in racism. Scholar Philip Jenkins notes that it derived from growing Western contact with non-Christian and polytheist religions in Asia and Africa, which were presented in the West in terms of primitive idolatry and ritual violence. Basically, in the late 19th century, as contact between different continents became more frequent, religious ideas began to blur across geographical boundaries, which seriously freaked out some Christians. People began writing anxious screeds about the rise of new religions, referring to them as cults, and the anxiety/name-calling has never gone away. But the line between cult and religion is so tenuous that scholar Reza Aslan notes, "The biggest joke in religious studies is that cult plus time equals religion." Randomly enough, rocker Frank Zappa also quipped that the only difference between a cult and a religion is how much real estate they own. Coincidentally, the Church of Scientology owns over $400 million worth of Hollywood real estate. And after seeing Going Clear, we can't be objective about these, very respectable and litigious individuals. But anyway, the difference between a religion and a cult is less black and white and more like a murky mood ring. We see this when we look at how American views on certain religious sects, particularly offshoots of Christianity, have changed over time. See, most books about cults published between the 1900s and the 1960s were fear-mongering about newer versions of Christianity, like Christian Science, Jehovah's Witnesses, and Pentecostal churches, which were supposedly doing Jesus-y stuff wrong. Today, such movements are now generally seen as relatively mainstream. So, absent a clear definition, what's an amateur cult investigator to do? According to scholar Dewey D. Wallace Jr., one simple definition of cults is small religious groups that are generally perceived as being outside the mainstreams of the religious life of a community and that hold views which the larger society finds unusual. Simple enough. Most scholars on the topic would add that another intrinsic element of a cult is a charismatic leader. But for real, this guy? This guy inspired the blind allegiance of a bunch of young hotties from all over the world? Now, the traditional media narrative about cults in America goes something like this. Cults emerged here during the 60s and 70s freaky-ass, hippie, free-love, youth, countercultural revolution, which some scholars call the Fourth Great Awakening. To be clear, this era did birth some cult classics, if you will. The Manson family, the People's Temple, of notable douchebag Jim Jones devising, the Hare Krishnas, and the Moonies, who accepted leader Sun Myung-moon as the next coming of Jesus. But still, that narrative obscures some broader historical truths. See, as Jenkins notes, when seekers of the 1970s bought books to guide their spiritual quest, they were usually rediscovering the thinkers and prophets of 30 or 40 years earlier. Which is to say, the 70s was very much about recycling old, new religious movements, like Theosophy, which, founded in the late 19th century, believed in a group of supposedly supernaturally powered masters in Tibet. This isn't that surprising, because the truth is, America has had cult-like groups for a long time, pretty much its entire history, in fact. In some ways, you could even argue that America was kind of built on cults. No, really, look, the New Yorker even says so. Indeed, American cults are arguably as old as the country itself. As historian Adam Morris writes in his book American Messiahs, False Prophets of a Damned Nation, the impulse to purify the group through separation from mainstream society, now regarded as the signature of a cult, could not be more fundamental to the nation's history. You could trace this to the Puritans, who came to America because they disapproved of the Church of England and wanted to restore Christianity, to purify it. Like People's Temple cult leader Jim Jones would mimic centuries later, pilgrims didn't believe in the concept of private property. Instead, everything, even your favorite pair of socks, was owned by the commons. They didn't poison themselves to death at the behest of a sadistic asshole, but Morris notes that many in England might have considered the Puritans to functionally be a cult. Since then, it's been a veritable game of Cults R Us. As Jenkins writes, cult booms or cult waves have been so frequent in American religious history that they are intrinsic to it. Most early cults, as mentioned, tweaked or reinterpreted aspects of Christianity. Though a common twist was that their leaders claimed to be handpicked by God himself. There was Jemima Wilkinson, who awoke from a bout of typhus fever to declare that her body had been requisitioned by God, plus a switch to male pronouns. He now called himself the public universal friend and attracted a huge wealthy following. Ignoring the literal battles going on in the Revolutionary War, he rode throughout the colonies warning about a coming apocalypse. And he wasn't alone. But 1790 is when things really kicked off. Reaction to the rise of Enlightenment reasoning spurred what scholars called the Second Great Awakening, a period of intense religious fervor. Within 2 years of the movement, church membership exploded, and religious interest was especially intense amongst young people. The First Great Awakening in the early 1700s had stressed the concept of predestination. If you're destined to go to hell, all the times you helped a little old lady across the street don't mean peanuts. But the Second Great Awakening stressed the idea of purification through good deeds and true devotion, which meant even the snarkiest jerk with a track record of bragging about his custom Tesla could atone for his errors and, eventually, go to heaven. As folks rushed to fix themselves, they also turned their sights on broader society, looking to create heaven on earth. And this led inevitably to, you guessed it, cults. Indeed, this was a time of such religious excitement that any charismatic man or woman worth their salt could hop on a horse, find some people to preach to, and start their own little faction. Westward expansion also made it possible to steal, claim your own land, and to try to build your own little piece of heavenly earth. And that's exactly what happened. According to Montell, in the mid-1800s alone, more than 100 small ideological groups were created and subsequently fell apart. Some of these groups are more often classified as religious sects, but the vibes are still pretty culty. There were groups like the Shakers, so-called because they worshipped with such fervor that many would literally start shaking. Or maybe all the shaking was from pent-up, frustration, because the Shakers were required to be completely celibate. Relocated from Britain to America by its messianic female leader, the movement flourished amidst the Second Great Awakening. They also made delightful furniture. Or take the Oneida colony, where everyone lived in what was called a complex marriage, aka a form of free love in which you could and should have sex with everybody in the community, but you weren't allowed to actually couple up with your favorite local hottie. Which, save for the last stipulation, is basically just Bachelor in Paradise. Then there were the 19th century pilgrims, who also practiced communal ownership, but added some fun rules, like banning laundry, shaving, bathing, and thus appealing to the large faction of young people who would rather die than make their bed. Importantly, the Second Great Awakening coincided with a surge of growth in urban areas, as people flocked to factory jobs and left the small agrarian economy behind. As a result of ditching everything and everyone they'd ever known, new urban dwellers felt vulnerable and isolated. Scholars generally agree that this had something to do with the fervor with which people sought out new, unorthodox religions. Such experimentation continued throughout the 19th century, as the spiritualist movement took over society, with all the seances and Ouija boards a grieving Civil War-era widow could want. The 1920s saw another cult boom, with such a variety of organizations that scholars now call it a cult milieu. That's a cute way of saying lots of lonely freaks were losing their damn minds trying to talk to ghosts. New Age and occult groups flourished, some of which were more or less fetishizing Asian religions. At this point, you could find occult temples in just about every major city. Still, most converts were just joining offshoot groups of Christianity, which made a lot of folks who didn't want to see their religion tweaked very mad. Some of these groups, like the Latter-day Saints, would eventually become relatively mainstream. As Jenkins puts it, the cult oddities of the 1920s became the religious orthodoxies of the 1990s. Still, other movements were mired in controversy. Take the cult leader King Ben, who built a multi-million dollar organization on the backs of his literally malnourished followers by claiming to be the seventh and final messenger foretold by the Book of Revelations. In 1927, his already eccentric cult attracted fully justifiable scandal when he was tried for statutory rape of underage members. The press called it the trial of the century. It's important to note that, like in the 1960s and 70s, the youth population and culture was booming, which typically contributes to the rise in membership in alternative religions and or cults, because young people are, in the fondest way possible, open to new ideas. And the rise of cults in the early 20th century resulted in a huge backlash. Laws about separation of church and state weren't as strong back then, so cults were easily repressed in the courts and by the legal system. This especially escalated during the lead-up to World War I and World War II, when many pacifist members of alternative religions refused to enlist and were subsequently jailed. Membership flatlined, and by the 1950s, cult groups had mostly receded from popular concern. Here are the 60s and 70s, when cults re-emerged within the counterculture movement. Or did they? There's some argument over the topic. Jenkins, for his part, argues, if we take the loose criterion for cult affiliation that critics used in these years, then the 70s were scarcely more cultish than other periods, as for example the 1930s. But even if cults did grow, at least somewhat, that's probably not the biggest change that made the 60s and 70s the enduring hallmark of cult eras. Rather, it's a series of isolated tragedies. In particular, the Jonestown suicides and the Manson murders, which triggered what Jenkins calls an anti-cult reaction phase as intense as any in its history. Anti-cult activism thrived on stereotypes about these groups, based on the grisly tragedies. Those stereotypes were then happily parroted by the media. With the recent ubiquity of television and increased media focus on cults, a few still fringe groups had officially free-loved their way into the national zeitgeist. And they'd stay there, with anxiety surrounding cults only increasing alongside the satanic panic of the 80s and 90s.
It is important to remember that the source of all magic is the life force of the user. This is the teaching of the occult.
So, while cults are hardly a new arrival on the American social scene, cults and cultish institutions do seem to be thriving these days. According to psychologist Steve Eichel, a recognized international cult expert and president of the firmly anti-cult International Cultic Studies Association, there are up to 10,000 cults in America as of 2018, and at least 13 of them are improv theaters. But what's thriving even more? Scary media about cults, which makes them a bigger boogeyman than they probably are by invoking newer tragedies like the Heaven's Gate mass suicide. Unspeakable tragedies aside, most cults are functionally pretty harmless. Indeed, according to scholars, public perceptions of cults as violent and extremist have been shaped by a small sampling of horrible incidents. And to be clear, these are really, really horrible incidents, like writing blood on the walls horrible. But cults also look different than they used to. While for much of American history, cultish groups skewed towards some adapted version of Christianity, and while many 19th and 20th century cults incorporated either Eastern or occult influences, today's cultish entities are, like much of broader society, far more secular and often explicitly intertwined with capitalism. And while cults of the Second Great Awakening often preached ideas that were super radical for the time, like gender and racial equality or anti-capitalism, today's more harmful cults seem most preoccupied with exploiting the economic anxieties of followers and potential recruits. One recent contender, Nexium, is an especially pernicious example of what a secular cult based on our current values looks like. Nexium jargon bottled up ideas from self-improvement manuals concerning personal empowerment and urged followers to, and I f***ing quote, ethically control as much of the money, wealth, and resources of the world as possible within my success plan. Here, we see this inexplicable cult leader essentially codifying tenets of capitalism into his belief system itself. Similarly, think about the boom of multi-level marketing corporations in recent decades. No, your Aunt Linda the Avon lady isn't necessarily in a cult, but the core elements of modern cults and multi-level marketing schemes are practically identical.
They're the same picture.
An intense passion backed by a flimsy ideology? Check. Fervent devotion to a leader at the top? Pretty much check. Sick swag? You bet. Whether that swag is some combination of spiritual enlightenment and making sick bank, or a combination of being a total girl boss and making sick bank, it's hard not to see cults and MLMs as siblings separated at birth. What really cements that similarity is how involvement in these groups fundamentally changes the focus of your life, as members of these groups feel connected over the common goal of, say, selling fancy leggings. And it just so happens that many of these members are willing to pay thousands of dollars to buy endless stock of said leggings, or to attend pricey MLM conventions where they can further commune with their fellow members. Anecdotally, one former MLM member told the MLM-themed podcast, The Dream, that she skipped her best friend's wedding for the privilege of attending such an annual convention. MLMs often have strong religious undertones, which are typically funneled through the lens of the Protestant work ethic. This encourages people to, simply put, work their butts off. Despite the fact that, according to Dr. John M. Taylor at the Consumer Awareness Institute, 99% of participants will lose money. Also, they're usually just literal pyramid schemes. Well, pyramid schemes that kind of hijack people's lives and have led to massive lawsuits and the formation of giant anti-MLM Facebook groups. Of MLM leaders, Montel writes, "They convert you with compliments and exclamation points and vociferation. They condition and coerce you with loaded buzzwords, often invoking God, and they use thought-terminating cliches to silence dissent." Pretty dark term for the philosophical descendants of Tupperware. So what explains the continued prevalence of religious and secular cultish groups today? Well, it may simply be indicative of general social turmoil. Like in the Second Great Awakening, when all the nice farm people had to suddenly transition into an urban market economy, recent years have been tumultuous too. Most people, especially young people, have to transition into an unsteady workforce, often with tens of thousands of dollars of student loan debt. As Montel puts it, society's attraction to so-called cults tends to thrive during periods of broader existential questioning. Most alternative religious leaders come to power not to exploit their followers, but instead to guide them through social and political turbulence. Anyway, while America may cycle through some cult booms, anti-cult flare-ups, and subsequent cult busts, they've remained a mainstay of our country's religious and social fabric. That leaves us wondering, is there something inherently cultish about American culture? In a New Yorker review of American Messiahs, writer Tom Bissell argues, maybe? He cites everything from our distaste for tradition, to our sexual repression, to our entrepreneurial spirit, to our Protestant work ethic, and concludes, perhaps we don't fear the cult because it threatens the American way. Perhaps it reminds us of exactly who we are. But what do you guys think? Are cults as American as apple pie? What does our long history of cultish groups say about us as a country? Let us know in the comments. Big thanks to our patrons for all your support. Slam that subscribe button like you're shutting the door on a Jehovah's Witness. And don't forget to ring that bell. And as always, thanks for watching. Peace.